चेयरपर्सन्स, गुड मॉर्निंग फ्रेंड्स. यू आर नॉट हियर टू प्रमोट क्रॉनिक हिमोडायलिसिस कैथेटर्स, बट वी हैव कम टू अ सिचुएशन वेयर वी दो हेट देम, बट वी हैव टू लर्न टू लिव विद देम. एंड दिस वॉज एग्जाम्पलीफाइड ऑलमोस्ट 15 ईयर्स बैक बाय प्रोफेसर जेराल्ड बेथर्ड, हु इज कंसिडर्ड फादर ऑफ इंटरवेंशनल नेफ्रोलॉजी इन द वर्ल्ड. सो हैविंग सेड दैट, लेट्स स्टार्ट विथ एन ऑडियंस सर्वे. I believe all of us have tunneled dialysis catheter in our unit. So, okay. How many patients at your center start with heavy fistula? How many for more than 75%? Anyone? No? 50%? No? Or is it the last?
Yeah.
Okay. So, we all know that early heavy fistula placement is the best thing to do, but the fact is also that we are not able to achieve that target. Okay, so how many patients start with non-cuffed catheters, their first dialysis, chronic patients? More than 75%? Anybody? Yes, everybody. Anybody for the lower figures? No. So almost everybody starts with non-cuffed temporary catheters. How many of you follow the principle of inserting primary tunneled cuff catheter? Few? Yeah? Okay. I mean, why do you put tunneled catheter? As a bridge to transplant? Anybody? Dr. Rajapurkar?
Yeah.
Waiting for heavy fistula to mature? 6 weeks of non-cuff catheter. Now let's change. Yes? Or primary TCC because the vessels are bad to begin with? Yes. Or is it the last resort where patients had had multiple catheters, multiple fistulas have failed? Yes? Okay. Okay. So this was a study published where they found that 21% of the patients were being dialyzed on their last dialysis session in USA. Okay? We are worse than that. At Lilavati Hospital, 1 week, 107 patients dialyzed. At their last hemodialysis session, almost 40% of the patients are being dialyzed with tunneled cuff catheter. We have no grafts. 4 patients on acute catheter and 63 patients on acute. Out of these 40, about 30 are the ones whose fistulas have been made but not matured, and 10% are the ones whose multiple fistulas have failed and they have no other access but to be on tunneled cuff catheter forever in their life. Okay. So that brings us to a question: who should be putting the catheters? See, we as nephrologists have been putting temporary catheters, but we don't put permanent catheters often because we allow radiologists to take over, vascular surgeons to take over. Intensive is because they think they put a lot of central lines, they can put it. Oncosurgeons have started putting it because they put Hickman, so they think this is also same, not realizing the fact that for Hickman's catheter, you just need to push medicines, whereas for our hemodialysis catheter, we need to draw the blood at the rate of 300 plus. ml per minute. Any nephrologist, or it should be a trained interventional nephrologist who does not find much standing in the hospital, in the cath labs, because others think. So here is a situation where a poor nephrologist sitting right at the bottom and everybody sitting on top of his head. So having put these catheters, which is a good way for an access, we need to know how best to put the place it, position it, how to take care of it, and how to treat if there is any complication. I would not touch all these aspects, but we'll try to put some of them. Okay. So we have this short-term catheters or non-cuff catheters. Versus that, we have cuffed catheters, and which is tunneled and which has a cuff, so that it prevents infection. It does allow no-needle dialysis with high flow rates. And of course, it avoids the problem of vascular stiff. Now, there have been various sites at which the catheters have been inserted. IJV is the most preferred site. Left IJV is less preferred than right IJV. We have now started putting catheters in external jugular veins, especially in those cases where IJVs are thrombosed and the EJVs become dilated so that it becomes easy to put the catheter. Subclavian veins as a tunneled catheter now are almost given up. We have now cases where we have put transfemoral route. One can put it in the external iliac veins. We have now about 10 cases of translumbar insertion, and there have been reported cases of transrenal and transhepatic vein. But of course, the long-term outcomes are very bad in those sites. When we put the catheter, we must go by the ultrasound. This has traditionally been a radiologist domain, and we as nephrologists thought that ultrasound machine is something which is too complicated to handle. But I will show you that unless we use that, it's going to be more and more difficult to insert catheters. Now, it's not very difficult. One needs to just get trained. You can see your needle getting in. This is the vein, which is compressible. This is the artery. And then once you enter in, you can actually see the tip of the needle right into the vein. And then one can just aspirate blood, confirm that you are in the vein. This has to be very meticulously done, as we found in this particular case, where the vein was situated just anterior to the artery. Now, without the ultrasound guide, for this particular patient, it was very easy that one could have gone into the artery and not into the vein. So ultrasound guidance becomes a very important part of inserting tunneled cuff catheter. And then one needs to get trained to hold the probe with the left hand and the needle in the right hand and looking at the monitor and then puncture. It's just, and then of course you need to have a fluoroscopic guidance, because everything which you do should be guided in today's era. So having said that, let's start with the video present. Okay. IJV.
Okay.
So we are just getting ready.
Sure.
With the camera. Ultrasound. Okay. So we are going to show you a live case where we put the camera. Because this is the ultrasound.
Fine.
That you can see this vein which is compressible. And this is how the probe is being held.
By the time this is done, one needs to be sure that all the air bubbles
which are there in the cuff
line
are removed by putting saline.
You
can see the needle coming in there, and
you can see my needle touching the vein, the traditional point where I would have come.
Traditionally,
we are going
one
from
would
lateral
go
point here
by the anterior approach, but with the ultrasound guide, you go for a lower lateral approach, as I was pointing my needle at, and then you hit the vein. You can see in the longitudinal section, your needle entering in, into the vein. That's where you are in the vein.
Yeah.
To get the blood flow, and then you need to put the guide wire.
Yeah.
And as you put the guide wire, just make sure that you are visualizing.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, so we went and also make sure
the needle.
Your guide wire goes right down. Try to position it way below into the IVC if possible.
Can see that image?
Once having done take the measurement. But you see, this was the catheter, and with
this
is spirals that
all the catheter
that's
like
the palindrome catheter.
Okay. Yes. Okay.
Which eliminates the problem of flows. You can actually reverse the ends and still achieve good flow, because both tips open at the same level.
One can take a long LP needle so
now
that you don't
have
multiple punctures.
And now we are going to. So having infiltrated the tunnel, make a small nick. Just do a blunt dissection.
Okay.
Make room for your cuff to be placed properly, because sometimes there are a lot of fibrous tissue, fat, etc.
Okay. Okay.
Now, After that, just load the tunneler.
Okay,
so this tunneler is different
like
because
this.
Both ends open at the same end. So it
sir.
Is a two-prong tunneler. One end is having two prongs. So once you do that,
okay.
Dilate this first.
You can see my prefer straight. Some people
then
prefer to bend this.
What we do is usually
good
bend
like
correct.
This.
So that
okay.
It gives
so
a good
way.
Grip. And then just push it.
There are no vessels that you encounter in the subcutaneous tissue.
No.
No.
Okay. Can you see this come out?
Oh, yes.
Okay. Now I am going to just pull it out. Okay.
Okay.
Once I am out, first thing I do is I disconnect this.
Disconnect
it. Put it into the tunnel. Okay.
Before you do this maneuver to manage the cuff, make sure that we have removed the.
Okay, this is the third dilator,
okay.
And this is the peel off sheath.
Now, this is the third dilator.
This
of
is the flow guard.
What is called as a
okay.
Flow guard.
So, dilator
is the
like
valve.
Yes.
So,
I have removed
it. The catheter.
Now, what I am going to do
lock
is
this.
Lock this. You saw this locking?
Okay. So,
okay.
It's unidirectional.
This has a valve which is unilateral.
Okay.
It is soft.
This will go in softly.
I put my
third
dilator through this
of the set.
Okay.
Right.
Lock
right.
It.
Lock this.
And now this is the dilator.
This is locked.
Which is inside a peel away sheath.
So we put the thinnest
okay.
Dilator
first. Thinnest dilator
first. Right. The first.
Okay. Fluoron.
Once you do that.
Okay.
Now everything, your
right.
Entry in should be monitored.
Every time I come
the,
out,
so
I need a
every right time left. You put in your dilator into the vein, just make
every
sure that.
Okay.
Now
yeah.
This is the second dilator going
follow me.
Again under vision.
Yeah, you can see this
always
going in.
Yes.
Because you don't want
not
to
leave.
Damage this? Any vessel
oh, okay.
Or the heart.
Okay.
And
now
the
I unlock this.
Put with peel away sheath.
Okay, this is unlocked.
And
I'm going to pull
that.
This
pull
dilator and the guide wire together.
The
and because there is a flow guard, it's not going to bleed. No, it will be sucked in. Okay.
Hold both of them and pull it out.
Okay, I'm going in.
See, there is no blood coming out, no air would rush in because it's
yeah.
Unidirectional.
Okay.
Valve.
Show it there.
And then
now we follow it on the floor.
Again,
upper
left. You can see your
catheter
okay.
Hold,
coming
hold.
In.
Okay. You can, this
yes.
Is my catheter
this is
inside
yes.
The sheath.
And
yes.
The
follow me.
Catheter getting
correct.
Advanced.
Going smoothly.
Right there.
Smoothly.
You can see this?
Mm. Once you have gone in completely.
Okay.
Okay.
Now what we have to do is
just
we have to break this sheath.
Break it. You need
okay.
The force.
How do you
break
the sheath?
They're
pulling
one.
It apart.
Once
pull it apart,
that,
press it downwards. Okay.
You can do it with one hand.
This
you
way.
Don't need an assistance.
You can see my
finger.
Okay, this is in.
Put
yeah,
your
you
finger
push
in.
It further in.
So
yeah.
It's going to be two opposite
and
forces being applied. Your finger is
pull
pushing
both
it
of it
in.
Together.
Yeah.
Your
see, I'm pulling it. Can you see this pulling?
Yes, yes.
I'm
the pulling finger, you keep it pressed.
And I'm
there. You are. Make sure the was absolutely perfect. Make sure the
smooth flow.
Yes.
Is good.
Okay. This is repairing the line here. Yeah.
Both sides are good flow.
So the tip.
The tip is right in the center of the right atrium.
Okay.
You can
see right in
the
right atrium.
Tips of this catheter.
Yes.
It's
yes.
Not a staggered tip.
See the catheter
yes,
is
yes.
Just there. Okay. So making sure that you are just going above. Okay. You have to take a mattress switcher.
You see that
the next case which we are going to do, Dr. George,
yes.
Site is very,
I'm going to
very
show another technique of entering into the vein with the help of this new system which company has devised.
Sometimes
it's called VenaTrack.
Yeah.
Where or what we call as sheathless entry. So we will not use the peel off sheath but use this VenaTrack system and show how it can be still entered in. Okay, this is the first mattress switcher which I'm going to take. This is 2-0, so you need to take 4 or 5 switches, otherwise it tends to slip off.
Mm.
Okay?
Yes.
Yeah, no, little bit. Yeah. One more. Now you have to be very careful because now you don't have the liberty of
switcher.
Okay. Now see,
you
I'm taking the switcher here. Can you see this?
Stay switches.
Yes, yes.
At the side
okay.
Of exit. Now, there have been lot of issues about this, whether you should put this catheter completely inside.
In three stages. Number one, just the skin.
Use the catheter. What I prefer to do is
to make it
try to put it in.
Hole here.
In case our measurements are not correct and we happen to have
can
the
see
key
this?
Which is
yes.
placed
I've
deeper
gone
than
the hole.
Middle of the
yeah.
right atrium.
Okay.
We have
I'll
some room to maneuver. In case you have kept
one
it outside and then if you end up with a
go
key
around
which is say at the junction of SVC with RA,
and take one
then
more
that's going to be difficult. Pulling it back and leaving the tip
okay.
in the right
you can see this
in the SVC
this
is not a good proposition.
Will prevent the
pull
out. Pull out
that is where
like
your
this.
Chances of thrombosis
correct.
Will
okay.
be much more. So just
take and this. Similar on the other side.
Similar on the opposite.
Here because we had a perfect positioning, so we can afford to have
we
it.
Have just check the flow and lock
that's
it with heparin.
Okay.
Now, can you focus on this? Yeah.
Now, see, the if you
yeah.
see,
you can see
1.9 cc
ulta.
Of heparin.
Yeah. Okay.
And even this will
even
be 1.9 cc. Unlike
yeah.
in the
1.9.
staggered
1.9.
catheter.
Okay.
That's
so both
maxi-
of the okay.
available
okay.
from Covidian.
This
is the
okay.
palindrome catheter, which will have same. So one needs to know what size of catheter one has used,
fine.
What
fine.
Type of catheter one has
okay.
used, what is the locking
here we go.
Amount of heparin which is going to be required. Whatever is mentioned
is
on
9.
The catheter, add 0.1 to that and use that much of
this will be a
concentrated
one.
Heparin
I will leave
to lock the catheter. So
okay.
Just
fine.
Lock it
fine.
With the perfect amount.
Cap.
Then
put the
ready.
Caps on.
No. This is what one would do traditionally with a T-Lava sheath. There are situations where one needs
and
to change
pressure.
Over the catheters
yeah.
because of malfunction.
Dr. Herman.
Yeah.
Whatever.
Dr. Deepak.
Or
yeah, Deepak.
There are situations
yeah.
Where there is a
pediatric patient around age of 9 or 10 years.
Disease. Yeah.
But for that purpose, there is a
yeah,
system now available.
Hello?
Which is called as Vinatrex system.
System.
And this is what we are. Now this is what comes with higher ends of the palindrome catheters. Now these are the two
okay.
double
and
D configured
it is actually
stiff
the D configuration.
Wire.
The dark blue color
so,
here.
Which are of
like
different
that,
lengths
D,
and which just fits snugly into
exactly
the double D configuration of the catheter inside. So once you put this in, then
here.
It makes it stiff enough for the catheter to be inserted.
Vinatrex system.
So this
okay.
is how one puts the.
Can you see this? I've opened this.
This is before the catheter is inserted.
Yes. Any
put
side.
One end will go in each end, and you will see that it's unequal length. So one tip will always. You can put anyone in anyone. There is not an issue because the design is such that one will always be more advanced than the other one. It's little difficult because it just snugly fits in. So one has to be careful also not to damage or bend it.
No, it just snugly fits into the diameter. So this is going to be little resistance, but if you continue to push it gently and firmly, okay.
So we have tunneled the catheter.
From there.
Now we are trying to.
Okay, here.
So one end has come out.
It has come out, and I have locked it here.
Now,
okay.
Lock it.
Now I'll do this.
Put the other end, and now you see.
Now we come from
one
here.
End is anterior to the other. Now we need to thread the guide wiring from the distal end. And you see there is a eye inside.
Can you see this?
So
yeah.
There is a lumen inside.
I come from here.
Just bring it out from that lumen.
I have to bring
and then thread it.
Out
so now
eye.
It becomes a single system. And once you have that, that's hardened catheter. And one can actually put this in through a narrow vein or a stenosed vein. And
okay.
It or previous. So this is how you
Dr.
thread
George,
it in.
I came out, this guide wire has gone in from here,
yeah.
come out from this eye and thread into the
so
other
it's
link.
Come from here, come
and
out from the eye and gone
other.
Into the other link of the Vinatrex system.
Okay.
And push the guide wire till it comes out from the other end. it doesn't matter whether you put one on either side, because it will just take
ready
its
to
own,
enter in without
out.
A peel of sheet. And what you have to do, yes, it has to come out. So, yeah. So make sure that guide wire tip is out, okay?
Okay, now, once that this has been done, in this case we have just dilated the track, not used the peel away sheet, and with the help of inner track, we have just gone in and pushed it. Now,
gone.
That's it.
Pull out the guide wire first.
Pull the guide wire out. It will no need to clamp, because now, once you remove this,
make
you need
sure
to be careful and clamp it as soon as it comes out. Again, this one, remove the lock, pull it out.
You note one thing, that when this system is in, the clamps are open,
right,
and it does not bleed.
There is no need to clamp,
okay,
till it comes out. But as soon as it comes out, you need to clamp.
Okay.
So this is a modification of what we would do. So there are some pulse here. So if you are unable to advance the wire, always use fluoroscopy. That's the first thing. Don't try to, you know, push it too much. Avoid moving the guide wire back and forth through the right atrium and right ventricle, because it can have arrhythmias. You try to position it in IVC, because you will have three advantages. You will avoid arrhythmias. Of course, you are sure that once you have crossed the diaphragm, you are bound to be in the vein and not in the artery by any mistake. And sometimes the flow is so high that if you have kept the guide wire high up, it just tends to flip back. So once you have positioned it in the IVC, it will provide you stability. Use fluoroscopy when advancing dilators to minimize the risk of atrial injury. And the cuff position should be at least 2 to 4 cm from the skin to prevent infection. And in case you are finding it difficult, give a patient head low position so that you are able to enter into the vein bed. But then, of course, catheters insertion also have its problem, and there's a big list of them. And the one which I would like to highlight is this blood loss and the risk of air entering in, and that can be avoided by this system, which is called as flow guard, which I showed you, which is a unidirectional valve. So once you put it in, then then you are sure that your dilator can go in, but no blood loss, no air can enter in, because it's a huge 16 French sheath. So, and with the blood which sitting into the RA, the blood can. Now these are some of the cases which are referred to me. Now see, this patient had a pump placement without fluoroscopy, and this is what you landed up with, a tip almost in the SVC. This is an undesirable position. But there are people. Now this case was done by a cardiovascular surgeon, vascular surgeon. This was done by a cardiovascular surgeon, and see, this is the result they gave us. Again, same thing, this is done under fluoro, bad position. This guy has put it, so same patient, because this did not work, so they put the other one, and see this acute angle of the tip here. Obviously this catheter is not going to work. So this lady was then referred to us, because she was not getting dialyzed, she was very obese, and then we found all these veins were thrombosed, and we did our first external jugular vein catheterization in this patient, which worked well, and patient's uremic symptoms disappeared because she could. Or this one. If you are going to use femoral catheter, don't use the conventional 36 or 40 centimeter catheter. This catheter is going to cause thrombosis and never going to give you a long-term results. If you are going to put the femoral or translumbar, make sure at least your catheter crosses the level of the renal veins. If you can place it into the right atrium all the way up, that's the best. But if you can't, because the length is short, at least try to cross the level of the renal veins. This is again undesirable. And what happens to the tip? Why? I mean, there have been lot of controversy whether your tip should be at the junction of upper one-third and lower two-third of RA or center of RA. I personally prefer that the tip should be in the center of RA, because in patients with broad shoulders, patients with large breast and all, when you breathe, see how the catheter moves. It comes from here to here. So if you are too much high in the right atrium and the patient breathes and the catheter tends to pull back, get pulled back into the SVC, then the flow problems will come. These are some of the cases which we encountered where patients had had multiple catheters and then was referred to us for as a last resort that now do something, fistula will fail. Now this patient, see this, all the vein, where are you going to get an access? This is, we have punctured an external jugular vein thinking, and see the IJV is blocked here, IJV is patent but no way down there. Same patient here, we try to go in and it's blocked here. The same patient, SVC is blocked here. So ultimately we landed up, so this is a catheter coming in from IJV, this is a coming from femoral, and this much part is thrombosed. So this is of course related to multiple previous catheters. Or look at this patient. This is a MR venogram without dye, where you can see IJV is thrombosed, right IJV, left IJV is thrombosed, very thin EJV. This is your brachiocephalic which is thrombosed, and this is your SVC which is patent. So one can get this, and in a difficult situation, one needs to do proper venous mapping, and this can be done. If Doppler is not going to give us an answer, MR venography without gadolinium can give you this quality of pictures, and one should take use of help with this sort of technology, and then you can plan what you are going to do. And this is one case which we just encountered last week. Anybody, this is perfect position or not? No? Why? Yeah, it's little bit down, but otherwise, so this catheter is inserted, there is no flow. There is no flow. Anybody? No. Patient was absolutely comfortable, but no flow. We thought that we are in the, you would believe that you are in the vein and the RA.
Zygous.
Yeah? Okay. Doesn't look to be, yes. This is the perfect position as it appears, but we have actually gone into the posterior mediastinum. The IJV was blocked, so the guide wire, after getting the initial puncture, somehow took its own course and from the IJV punctured the pleura and went into the pleural cavity on the right hand side. Luckily, patient had no pneumothorax, and what we did then was just punctured the IJV right higher up under sono guidance again. With that, making that guide wire as a guide, made a lower puncture hitting the guide wire. So now we are in the vein, made sure, put a sheath, put dye, made sure that we are in the proper vascular system, pulled back that catheter from the mediastinum, gave pressure for 5-10 minutes just to achieve tamponade, no pleural air entering in, and then just reposition the catheter. So one has to be careful about this.
One sort of need to.
Yeah, this is the last slide. Okay. So, as we all know, hemodialysis is the dominant treatment. Okay, peritoneal dialysis has stabilized, transplants are stable. So we need to have long-term patients' needs to be addressed too, and that's why we need to address the vascular access problems. And then we have a lot of large future workload, more resources are needed. And I would personally feel that vascular access, which is so to say neglected, should be included in standard training during our training program. Thank you very much. And before I end, I would like to invite all of